We're back in our TCPIP Basics course, and let's do a demonstration of some of the different tools that come with the Windows operating systems. These are the different IP tools, and you'll find these are very useful for doing troubleshooting and checking basic connectivity. So the first thing we want to look at is ping. So you can see on the left-hand side of the screen, I've written out all of these different tools, and I've also included some switches to go with them that will tell us additional information about the devices we're trying to communicate with. So for instance, if I do a ping and I type in an IP address, I should get a reply if that IP address is alive and allowing what's called ICMP requests. Many firewalls block ICMP requests, so we may not get a response even if the device is alive. But in this case, our Google DNS server I'm trying to ping is alive and responding. So instead of just pinging IPs, we can also ping host addresses such as google.com, just as an example. And we get a response and we see the IP address there. So everything is working as it should. Now we have some other commands. Let's take a look. We have the ping minus A. So what that does is it goes out and it takes the IP address and sees if there's a host name that's attached to it. So let's do the same address we did last time. And we can see that it says google-public-dns. So it tells us that this is a DNS server. Now the name doesn't always match up to what you think it's going to be, but in this case, Google did actually name it what it actually is, which is a DNS server. So that's great. So the ping minus A does a reverse lookup. So instead of looking up the name to the IP address as we did without the minus A, it did the IP address to the name. Now let's do a minus T. And we can see what that does. And the default is going to be to respond using four replies. But when you do a minus T, it does a continuous reply until you hit the Control C key command. Now we've gone ahead and stopped our ping by hitting Control C. This is similar to what would happen if you used the ping command in a Linux or Unix environment or Macintosh, but by default, they will do continuous pings without typing in the minus T. They won't do just the four pings and stop as you see what happens in Windows. All right, let's go ahead and clear our screen again, and let's choose the minus L. So let's go ahead and get rid of the minus T, and I'm going to put the minus L over on the end. And what that's going to do is it's going to allow us to set a size. So by default, in our previous pings, we got just 32 bytes of data, which is a fairly small size. But what we want to do now is we want to manually set the size to be a much larger amount. So let's just go ahead and put in 512. So we can see it now says sent 512. So that means that that's how many bytes of data that we're sending instead of the old default. And that's simply by setting the L. And you can go as large as you want. Now this is what happens actually during a denial of service attack when many different computers all try to ping the same IP address or name over and over until it fills up the pipe. But in your case, I don't think one computer with a 512 packet size is going to cause any kinds of problems. So you can go ahead and do that. So the reason we would even want to do that is because sometimes a small packet may get through and you may not realize that there's a problem going on. So you want to send a larger packet to see if it also goes through. And if it doesn't, or if the ping time is much higher than what you would expect, then that means there's a lot of IP fragmentation going on, or there could be some connectivity issues. Now let's do what's called an ARP command. Let's type ARP and we'll type in minus A. Hit enter. So what the ARP command does is it tells us any other IP addresses in the same local area network that it can currently communicate with. So we see I'm communicating with my 192.168.15.1 address, that's my router, and my 15.2 address, that's the host for my virtual machines. And then we have other IP addresses as well, 4 and 5. Now the 255 is the broadcast address. You're always going to see the ARP command show the broadcast address because we're constantly trying to find other devices on our network. Now, the 224 and the 239, those are all going to be the devices that we're not going to be able to use for our local IP addresses. They're used for multicast and scientific uses. So we don't really need to pay much attention to anything at the 224 or above level. And we covered multicast and these other IP addresses in previous videos in this playlist. So if you want to learn more about those, you can check out that video. The ARP command is also really useful if someone turns off their ICMP by blocking it using a firewall. Even if you can't ping them, they're still going to show up in the ARP command, so you can see whether or not that IP address is alive. All right, let's go on to Traceroute. Traceroute is a way we can check to see how many hops between our location and a destination location. So let's go ahead and type in our all eights again for our Google DNS server, and we'll go ahead and hit enter. So what's happening now is it's checking out each of the hops or the routers between my computer and our Google DNS server. And you can see it also resolves the names to IP addresses along the way. This is useful because we can see that we went through Troutdale to Seattle, and we're sort of finding our way to our router. We can kind of see the physical locations as well when they show them. We also see a request timed out. Sometimes that does happen, but if you're patient, then usually the next hop or two will go through unless ICMP is once again being blocked. And we can see in this case that we are getting blocked at a specific router, and that sometimes happens. So we can just hit Control C to stop it. And now it's stopped. Let's go ahead and do Traceroute just to a local computer, and we can see that we're just one hop away, just so you can see. And there it is. Now, the reason we would want to use Traceroute is if we want to get to a certain destination, we want to see if it's being blocked at any point along the way. We also want to see if there's a better route to that destination from a different location. So let's say, for instance, you want to use a public DNS server to resolve names to IP addresses, as we all do when we want to go on the internet. Well, we want to get a DNS server with the best response. And pinging that server is a good way to find out if it's a good response, but also running a traceroute to see how many hops it is to get from our location to the DNS server is another good way to find out how long it's going to take for that device to respond. So traceroute can be used for that, as well as using to see if we're getting any type of routing errors along the way. I also like to use the minus D switch, and what that does is it keeps it from resolving the IP addresses to the names, so the traceroute goes a little bit faster. If we need to get the names, you can take the minus D out. Let's take a look at our next command called pathping. Pathping is a Windows command that is a combination of the traceroute and the ping command. So if I put in pathping, and I'll go ahead and put in a different address, let's just put in a Verizon address, and we'll hit enter, then we see that it does a very similar thing to the traceroute in that it checks all the hops, but then it also looks a lot like the ping command. At the very end, it actually gives you additional statistical information. Now, unfortunately, it has the same kind of limitations that the ping and the traceroute have, and that is if ICMP is being blocked, then you'll get this computing statistics for 125 seconds happen to you. So we'll go ahead and cancel that, and we'll do a path ping once again to our local router. And we'll see what we get there. And that's it. Just the two different hops. And when it's all done, it gives you some statistics. So for instance, it shows me that it only took 1 millisecond to get to my destination. So you need to wait a little bit after the last destination IP address or name has been reached, and then it's going to compute all these statistics for that information. We'll stop here and pick up the rest of the commands that you see there on the left in our next video.